Good morning. I want to welcome you to our online service today. Whether it's your first time joining us or you're a longtime member, we're so glad that you're here. You have a few more minutes to grab your Bible, get a drink, and get ready for worship this morning. We would love to say hello to you in the live chat. So join in the conversation this morning and let us know who's watching with you. Take these next 5 minutes to connect with your church family and prepare your hearts to hear the message that God has for you today. We love you and we're praying for you. God bless.
morning, church family. Pastor Steve here. I'm standing out here outside in front of the church because I wanted to invite you to our open house on June 7th, 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. It's going to be an opportunity for you to look at some of the enhancements we've made. We've done some spring cleaning. It's going to be a great time for fellowship, to walk around, to see people. And weather permitting, there'll be devotion outside, breakfast sandwiches, just a lot of stuff as we prepare to open the doors back up here at Bear Memorial. So I hope you can join us June 7th, 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. Hope to see you there. God bless.
Stories of the Bible. God sends the Holy Spirit. These are the apostles.
Hello.
They followed Jesus during his time on earth. Before Jesus went to heaven, he told them to stay in Jerusalem until God sent the gift he promised.
See ya!
So after Jesus went to heaven, the apostles stayed in Jerusalem along with the other people who believed in Jesus. One day, they were all gathered together when there was a sound from heaven like a mighty windstorm.
Whoa!
Then what looked like flames appeared and settled on each of them, and everyone was filled with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gave them the ability to speak in other languages, and so they started speaking. At that time, there were devout Jews from every nation living in Jerusalem. When they heard the loud noise, they came running to see what it was.
What's going on?
When they saw the believers speaking in their own languages, they were shocked and amazed.
Hey, do you hear this?
They wondered, how can this be? These people are from Galilee, and yet we hear them speaking in our own native languages about the wonderful things God has done. What can this mean?
Whatever.
But others in the crowd didn't believe that it was really a miracle and thought the believers were just acting oddly. Then Peter stepped forward and shouted to the crowd.
Hey, all you!
Listen carefully, all you. He told them that they were not acting strangely, but that this was from God. He reminded them that God said this would happen long ago. Then Peter told them about how Jesus was crucified, but then raised to life again, just as God had said he would be. He told them that Jesus was now in heaven and that God had given the Holy Spirit to them as he had promised. Peter's words changed what the people thought and felt, and they asked, "Brothers, what should we do?" Peter told them, "Each of you must repent of your sins and turn to God and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit."
Wow!
Peter continued to preach to the crowd for a long time, and those who believed what Peter said were baptized. 3,000 people were baptized and added to the church that day. Then all the believers listened to the apostles' teaching and practiced what they taught.
Hey!
They met together in fellowship, shared meals, and prayed together. They were amazed as the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. All the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had.
Here you go, take this.
Ah, thank you.
They helped those in need.
Here, this for you.
Thank you.
Worshiped together at the temple every day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy, all while praising God and enjoying each other. And each day, God added to their fellowship those who were being saved.
Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty. Through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. And I believe in God our Father, the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one, I believe in the resurrection. judge and I defend, suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious life. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son.
Your glory, God, is what our hearts long. Good morning, church family, and thank you again for joining us this morning for our live stream service. Today, before we get started, I wanted to say a quick congratulations to all of our 2020 graduates. You know, whether you graduated from high school, college, post-grad, whatever you're graduating from, I just want to say congratulations. All your hard work has paid off, and we celebrate that with you this morning. So before we go any further this morning, let's pray and give this time over to the Lord. Father God, I thank you so much for this morning. God, I thank you for your love. God, I thank you for our graduates. Lord, as it might not look like they intended it or had anticipated looking, Lord, but Lord, we still celebrate with them this morning, God, the achievement that, achievements, Lord, that they have been able to accomplish over these years. God, we pray now for this time. God, we pray, Lord, that you would be seen and heard, Lord, that we would walk away from this message, Lord, with the newness of how to live for you. God, we love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, as Christians, there's two major holidays that we celebrate. The first one we celebrate at Christmas time, and that would be Jesus' birth. Every Christmas, we celebrate the fact that our Messiah has been born. And the other major holiday that we tend to celebrate is the resurrection of Jesus, which happens on at Easter. These are the two major holidays that we focus on, the two major holidays that we tend to celebrate. But this morning, we are going to look at one that kind of gets lost in the shuffle. Today is Pentecost Sunday, so this morning we're going to be looking at Pentecost. What is Pentecost? Why is it significant to the church? Today is important because Pentecost is the birthday of the church. And God has given us an opportunity to be a part of his plan and what he's doing in the life of his church and his people. Pentecost is the day where the church receives power. This is the day where the Holy Spirit came and explodes on the scene, and he's the comforter that Jesus promised. He's the helper that Jesus promised that would come. He's the same Spirit that Jesus talked about before he ascended into heaven. And Pentecost is the day where we finally see the Holy Spirit come. And the Holy Spirit comes in a powerful way to do powerful things. Let's take a look at a couple of verses, and let's look at a few passages of Scripture where Jesus talks about the Holy Spirit coming. In the book of John chapter 14, Jesus tells his disciples, he says, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper," referring to the Holy Spirit, "that may be with you forever." And in the book of Acts, we read this. Before Jesus ascends into heaven, he says this, "For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and even to the remotest part of the earth." See, when the Holy Spirit came, the believers were filled, and the believers in the body of Christ was changed forever. This fulfilled promise from the Lord is the turning point in church history. Let's take a look at Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2 is where we see the day of Pentecost, where we see the Holy Spirit come down, and we see what happened. Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. We read, "On the day of Pentecost, 7 weeks after Jesus' resurrection, the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly there was a sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm in the skies above them, and it filled the house where they were meeting. Then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. Pentecost is associated with power. Now, power is one of those things that we're always trying to attain, right? If you ever watch a movie, if you ever watch any superhero movie over the past, well, forever, you know, there's always somebody trying to obtain power, and they're doing whatever they can to obtain power. We see this power struggle everywhere in life. We see a power struggle in the home. We might see a power struggle, you know, in your workplace. We see power struggles in politics all the time. Unfortunately, we also see power struggles in the church itself. This idea that we need power. And when we have power, power can be, you know, used in two different ways, at least two ways. It can either be unleashed or it can be harnessed. Now, I want you to think about, to kind of illustrate that. Think about if you had 20 gallons of fuel. That's a lot of fuel. You have 20 gallons of fuel. Now, the energy that fuel can release, like just dropping a match into it, is crazy. Think if you had a big barrel of fuel, 20 gallons of it, and you put threw a match into that barrel. What's gonna happen? It's gonna explode, right? It's gonna be a huge explosion. Now, just so you give you a little story about, a little history about me, is I am not good at making campfires. I am not an outdoorsy kind of guy. You know, when I go outdoors, I like there to be a beach and an ocean. That's my outdoors, right? But when we used to live in Shippensburg, we used to do campfires a lot. Whether it was when the youth group would come over and we'd do some kind of campfire, we'd have Bible studies, we'd have a campfire, or our kids just wanted to have a campfire in the backyard, roast marshmallows, those kinds of things. And they'd always ask, "Dad, can you make a campfire? Can you make a campfire?" And I would always think, well, how hard could this possibly be? Yeah, it's not that big of a deal. Make a campfire, people do it all the time. Well, I quickly learned that I am terrible at making campfires. So I started cheating a little bit, and I would go and buy those starter logs. You ever see these things? And my youth group kids used to always make fun of me for buying starter logs. Well, that's not how you do it. I'm like, I know. You guys are Boy Scouts. You guys did all this stuff. I grew up in Jersey. I didn't make a lot of campfires. All right, so I'd use the starter logs. And when that wouldn't work, when that didn't, you know, do what I wanted it to do, I would cheat even more. I would go into my garage and I would get the can of gas. And I would pour gas all over the wood. And then I would get my lighter and I would do one of these deals, you know, where you're just kind of like, yeah, and you're trying to light it without exploding, you know, instead of blowing yourself up. And so eventually the gas would catch on fire, and I can almost see the looks on your faces because you know exactly what happens. There's like this huge, quick explosion. Now, I have to praise God that I've never been hurt or burned. I still have my eyebrows and all those things. But, you know, it was really dangerous. In fact, I wanted to say, children, never do that. You know what? I'll take it a step further. Adults, never do that. Okay? Don't pour gas on the wood. Okay? Because it will make a big explosion. And you guys know what happens. Once all that fuel is burned up, once all that fuel is gone, what happens to the fire? It starts to go down. Because the fire burned up all the fuel, and then the fire slowly starts to die out again. Now, as believers, we can be like this. We are always looking for that explosive experience to get us on our spiritual path, to get us where God wants us to go. We're always looking for that huge boom to get us back in tune with God. You know, it's all about, and for a lot of us, it's all about that Sunday experience. You know, we come to church on Sundays. We want to come to church and experience God. That's where we come to experience God. You know, Monday through Saturday, we live however we want. We do what we want. We say what we want. We go where we want. But Sunday, we're going to get that godly experience. I mean, have you ever said those words? You know, I can't wait for church on Sunday because that's where God is. Well, it's not where God is. God is everywhere. God's in our hearts, and we can worship God wherever we're at. You know, we want to go to church and we want to come and have this wow experience. For a lot of times, it's where it stops. It's where it stops. We come to church, we praise God, and then the rest of the week we do what we want. Nothing really happens. So there's that explosion factor. On the other hand, you take that same 20 gallons of gas and you channel it through the engine of a motor vehicle, and if there's a controlled burn, that fuel can transport someone about 300 miles, depending on your vehicle. You know, it lasts a lot longer. That fuel, that power, lasts a lot longer when you spread it out, when you take it in doses, when it's controlled. See, God is looking for His church to have sustainability. He's looking for His church to be constantly on fire for Him. He's looking for His church and His people to be prepared to live for Christ daily, not just once a week, not just when the doors of the church are open, but our whole lives. God is looking for us to constantly be on fire from Him, that controlled burn, that staying power, not just that boom and then be done, but that power that's going to last throughout the weeks and months and years of our lives. Now, explosions are spectacular. I love explosions. If you like fireworks, you know, that's what a firework is. It's an explosion. It's a colorful explosion. You know, we like to do fireworks. 4th of July is coming up. I'm sure you're going to see fireworks. Explosions are great. But controlled burns have a much longer lasting effect. Now, as we look at the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, you know, he works in both ways. At Pentecost, He exploded on the scene as we read in our passage in Acts chapter 2. And then verses 5 through 16, you know, we see that people from all cultures and languages come running to hear and see what was going on. They come and some of them are amazed at what they're seeing, what they're hearing. They're hearing their own language being spoken and they're confused. But they're also excited. But you also have some coming and mocking what was going on. You have some coming there and mocking the fact and saying, you know, are these guys drunk? What's wrong with these guys? Like, these guys are crazy. What's wrong with them? And they're mocking them. And unfortunately, we see that in the church too, don't we? And sometimes we mock or tease those people who are trying to live according to the Scripture. We mock or tease and make fun of the people that are trying to live a righteous life. Somehow in the church, we have made living for Christ something to make fun of instead of something to embrace. We look down on those that might have high standards. We look down on those people who are trying to live according to Scripture. Why? Why do we do that? Is it to make ourselves feel better? Is it to make ourselves feel more worthy? It is something we should all be striving for, right? We should be all striving for living according to the Word, living a righteous life, living according to how God wants us to live. So the Holy Spirit comes, a crowd is gathering, and Peter steps up. Peter comes forward. Remember Peter? We know Peter, right? Mr. Cut off a soldier's ear, that Peter? Remember Peter, the man who sinks because he has little faith and he sinks? The man who's running his mouth every moment he gets. Mr. Denies Jesus 3 times. Mr. Always getting in trouble. Peter, the lowly fisherman who was completely unworthy to follow Jesus. Remember, he wasn't a student, he was a fisherman. Peter, who amounted to nothing, this man steps up. After the Holy Spirit came upon him, he steps up and he begins to preach to the people. Peter tells the people that this is the day that was predicted by the prophet Joel. The prophet Joel foretold that this day was going to come. And what did he predict about the church? This is what he says in Acts chapter 2, verses 17 through 21. It says, in the last days, God said, I will pour out my Spirit upon all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. And your old men will dream dreams. In those days, I will pour out my Spirit upon all my servants, men and women alike, and they will prophesy. I will cause wonders in heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and clouds of smoke. The sun will be turned into darkness and the moon will turn blood red. Before that great and glorious day of the Lord arrives, and anyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. This is what the prophet Joel prophesied so long ago. The prediction was that the Holy Spirit will empower the church, and His presence was like tongues of fire. And on this day, thousands were affected and changed by one burst of God's power. There was a mighty explosion, and the Holy Spirit comes upon them. Peter preaches, and when Peter's done preaching, 3,000 people were saved. 3,000 people. That's 3,000 lives that were changed. 3,000 hearts that were changed. 3,000 lives that were given over. 3,000 lives that were in the darkness, now they're in the light. 3,000. Because of the Holy Spirit coming and empowering a fisherman to get up and share the gospel and tell them who Jesus really is. See, there was an explosion again, and Peter did all these things. And something good to understand is God loves worship, right? God loves when we worship Him. God loves fellowship. Looking forward to these doors being open so we can worship together and we can fellowship together again. And that time's coming. Time's coming real soon. God loves when we serve Him. God loves all these things. But He wants His people to do those things filled with His power and filled with His Spirit. Not to do things in our own power, in our own strength. Not to try to live this Christian life by ourselves. Not to try to be obedient in our own way. To allow the Spirit of God to come into our lives and transform us and change us. God has given us all the power and all the tools that we need to live for Him. And yet we still want to do things our own way. We still want to live our own lives. We still want to do things our own way. God has given us everything we need to live for Him. God has given us the tools. There's nothing else we need to do. We just serve Him and follow Him and rely on Him and His strength and His power. I've heard it said so many times. You know, I can't do this. I can't get through this. I can't. You know what? That's right. We can't. We can't do anything apart from God. And we need to understand that. We need to realize that. Even preaching a sermon. One thing I never want to happen is this to be done in my power. I never want to stand before you guys and preach a message, you know, that the Lord has laid on my heart. I never want to do that in my power and in my strength for me. I don't want that. You know, I used to, a couple years ago, my word for the year was decrease. And every time I would, before I would preach a sermon, I would close my eyes and I would pray. And I would say, God, I'm going to decrease. You increase. This is not about me. I want You to be seen. I want You to be heard. And I still pray that every time I take the stage. Every time I open His word, every time I proclaim His message, it's not about me. It's not my power. I don't want it to be about my power. I don't want it to be about my strength. My strength is not sufficient. My strength is not good enough. I am flawed. I am weak. And when I'm weak, He is strong. And that's the power that we ask for. That's the power that we have in our lives. It's the power that God has given us. The beauty of the Holy Spirit. Now, I want you to consider this for a second. How many of you ever seen those weight loss ads? You know, whether it's on a computer or TV, you know what I'm talking about, like where they have the before and after picture. You know, this is how I looked before, after so much time, here's my after picture. Now, here's the catch with those pictures, is the after picture is supposed to look better, right, better than the before picture. That's why you're posting them. You're comparing. It looks different. It looks supposed to look radically different, your after picture from your before picture. Right? That's what we do. Well, the same is true with our spiritual life. So I want for a second, I want you to, if you can, imagine your life before you got saved. Now, for some of you, I understand you were maybe really young when you got saved, so maybe there wasn't a ton of life change. But if you can imagine with me what your life was like before you asked Jesus to come into your life, before you asked Jesus to save you, before you asked Jesus to transform you, what was your life like? Now take a snapshot of that. Take a mental snapshot of that. Now, I want you to look at your life now. Take a look at what your life looks like right now. Take a mental snapshot of that. Your before, your spiritual before and after pictures. Is there a difference? Is your after picture radically different than your before picture? And if not, I want to ask why. It should be. I look at my before and after pictures, and there's a radical change. Not to say I don't mess up, not to say I don't mess up and make mistakes and come short. We all do. But the mindset of our lives, our lives and the overall picture of our lives should look completely and radically different. And if not, why? Because if not, we're not allowing the Spirit to transform us. We're not allowing the Spirit to work in our lives. We are still trying to live in both worlds. We're still trying to say, I'm a Christian, I have the Holy Spirit, but yet I'm going to do what I want to do, when I want to do it, and no one's going to stop me. We're not allowing the Spirit of God to transform us. And this morning, I want us to shift our focus from our physical self to our spiritual self. And today, as we celebrate Pentecost Sunday, and we celebrate the birthday of the church, we need to understand that that's the after picture that's important. It's the after picture that's important. The day of Pentecost was a day that Jesus promised to his disciples. He would send them a comforter, someone to empower them, someone to help them do great and mighty things for the kingdom of God. Jesus told them, wait in Jerusalem, and they did. They waited for 120 days, and then God's promise was fulfilled. This day, this event, was the turning point in the lives of the disciples and for the church. Now, just for a moment, I want you to think of a time, or try to pick out a time in your life where you can point to, that turning point for you. You know, that this was, you know, you ever say that expression, this was a real turning point in my life, this part of my life transformed me or changed me, this was the turning point. We see it in sports all the time. You know, when they're talking to a coach after a game, you know, they'll say something like, this was the turning point of the game, or this was the turning point of the season. You know, think of that for a second. What happened in your life that was considered that turning point? Maybe it was the day your first child was born. You know, and after you hold your first newborn baby, your life is never the same, right? Or maybe when you finally have enough courage to ask out Mr. or Mrs. Wright. Or something else. You know, can you pinpoint a turning point? You know, because unfortunately not every turning point is positive, though. Well, the day, maybe it's a negative experience that's your turning point. The day you had that car accident, or the day you found out a loved one had died, the day where the doctor gave you bad news. We've all had turning points in our lives. It's almost a way of us marking out our way through life. We're trying to mark our lives in general. This morning, God wants you to have a turning point in your spiritual life. He wants to empower you and to make you more than you could ever dream of being on your own. He wants to give you more power and strength. Why? So you can be used more for Him. So you can do things you never thought you could. So you can go where you never thought you could go. So you'll see things that you never thought you'd see. God wants you to have a Spirit-led life. Now, I believe that the Word of God teaches us that unless we are living a life led and empowered by the Holy Spirit, we will not be able to live a life to the fullest. Jesus told us that we will have abundant life, right? We will have an abundant life. He never said we are going to have an easy life, but He says we'll have an abundant life. And unless we allow the Spirit of God to come into our lives and use us to transform us, we will never see that abundance of life. We won't see that fullness. We won't get the full measure of what God wants to do with us and in us and through us. We cannot experience the greatest things in life without it. Now, not the greatest things in life as far as society says is the greatest things in life. Those are two different things. The greatest things in life, according to society, are fame and money and, you know, all these different things. That's not what the Bible teaches. The greatest things in life and what God wants for us, that abundance, is our faith being built, to be used by Him. We get to be used by the King of Kings. We get to be used by the Creator of the universe. He wants us to be part of His plan. He doesn't need us. If we think God needs us to fulfill His plan and His purpose, then we're crazy. He doesn't need us, but He wants us. He chooses us He wants us to be a part of what He is doing. The Word of God also teaches us that we will not reach our God-given potential without being filled by the Holy Spirit. God chooses us. And He has so many things that He wants for us. And sometimes we don't even see our full potential in ourselves. Right? We see ourselves as one-dimensional. We see ourselves as what we are. You know, I've been watching The Chosen, and if you haven't watched it yet, I highly recommend you watch that show. It is phenomenal. And there's a scene where Peter and the other fishermen are fishing. They've been fishing all night, haven't caught any fish, and Jesus comes on the scene and says, "Cast out your net one more time." And they're all like, "Jesus, okay, whatever, we'll do it." And He does, and there's an abundance of fish. The Zebedee has to fill, he fills two boats up. They wound up filling two boats with fish. And then Peter comes, and he comes to Jesus, and he starts bawling. And he says, "You are the Christ. You are the Messiah." He says, "Depart from me. I'm no good, worthy fisherman. You don't know the things that I've done. You've chosen the wrong guy." And Jesus looks at him and says, "Lift up your head, fisherman. Lift up your head. I choose you. I want you." Peter says, "I'm just a fisherman. I'm only a fisherman." Jesus basically tells him, "No, you are so much more than that. Follow me. Follow me." If we look at the people that Jesus chose to follow him, fishermen and tax collectors, and people that society would think, "Who are these people?" Well, God chose them. God chooses us. He wants us. Do we want Him as much as He wants us? So we have the Holy Spirit to change us. Remember Saul? Well, I guess I should be more specific. Saul of Tarsus in the New Testament. You know, one of the most feared men in the entire known world. Who was he feared by? He was feared by Christians. And in case you don't know who I'm talking about Paul. He was feared by Christians. Paul was on a mission. It was a crusade. He thought it was a crusade for God. He thought he was serving God. He thought he was doing the right thing. And he would go around and persecute and do things in the name of God. And there's a lot of people throughout history who thought they were doing things for God, to honor God. They were doing some horrible things, but in the end, they were just doing things for themselves. They're doing things to fight against God. And this is where we find Saul. Saul goes out, and he was known for persecuting Christians, for killing Christians. That's what he did. It was his job. He was even responsible for the stoning of Stephen, the first martyr. Saul was there. He was responsible for it. And Saul's on his way to Damascus and to do what he does, to persecute Christians, have him thrown in jail, to kill him if needed. And while he's going there, he has a face-to-face encounter with God. Paul gets his God moment. Paul reaches his turning point in his life. Let's take a look at his encounter with the Lord. It's amazing. Let's take a look at it. In Acts chapter 9, verses 3 through 9, it says this. As he was nearing Damascus on his mission, a brilliant light from heaven suddenly beamed down upon him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. And the voice replied, "I am Jesus, the one you are persecuting. Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what to do." The men with Saul stood speechless with surprise, for they heard the sound of someone's voice, but they saw no one. As Saul picked himself up off the ground, he found that he was blind. So his companions led him by the hand to Damascus. He remained blind for 3 days, and all that time he went without food and water. Saul was knocked off his high horse, quite literally, right? When he met Jesus face to face, he was knocked off his high horse. He had a face-to-face encounter with the living God. And this is the same God that he was persecuting. He was humbled. Instantly humbled, instantly blinded. Now, he didn't have it all figured out. In essence, he was just a blind man who needed God. Now, as I've come to realize, that's true with me too. I'm just a blind man who needs God. When I look at the lives of Peter, and I look at the lives of Paul, these men just needed God. And I look at my life and I need God. I can't live this life apart from Him, nor do I want to. I need Him, because without His leading in my life, without His helping me, without His guiding me, without, you know, Him guiding my thoughts and my dreams, I can't survive. I won't survive. I can't get through another moment of this life without God's provision, without God leading and directing me. His Spirit showing me and leading me, telling me where to go, speaking to me. I don't want to live apart from that. You know, I can try to live my own life the way I want to, and so can you. But we will not be living the spiritually empowered life that God wants us to. We can live however we want. And many times we do. We can try to live apart from God. We can try to shush Him. We can try to stifle Him a little bit. We can live according to the parts of the Scripture that we want, and it'd be wrong. We won't be used by God the way He intended it. See, a lot of us, including myself many times, we're just content with mediocrity. We're okay and just content with so-so. We're okay and content with just kind of being average. Do we understand that when the Holy Spirit came, the power that was given to the disciples, why are we content with average? Why are we content with just being mediocre? Why are we just content with just going through the motions? Why do we want to embrace that power of God? In society, we are so quick to want to embrace power, money, fame, all those things. But God has given us His Spirit. Why aren't we more eager to take that and use it for His glory and for His honor? And again, I have to ask the same question to myself. The Holy Spirit came to empower the church. So what role does the Holy Spirit play in your life? What role does He play? You know, when you're making a big decision, do you pray about it? Do you ask God to help you? Do you listen for the leading of the Spirit? You know, in my personal spiritual journey, I have learned that those times where I feel I'm the farthest from God are the times I've pushed Him away. You know, I've stopped reading, or I've stopped praying, or I've stopped focusing on Him, and I've tried to do things in my own power, and I've pushed Him away. He hasn't gone anywhere. If we feel God is not near, it's because we have pushed Him away. It's not because He's gone anywhere. And we quench the Spirit. We don't allow the Spirit to do what the Spirit wants to do. During those times, you know, I have not allowed the Spirit to work in me and through me. And those are the times that I've got myself in trouble, because I've been trying to do things in my own power. And it doesn't work. It doesn't work. God delivered on His promise by sending us His Spirit on the day of Pentecost. God delivered on His promise by sending us His power on the day of Pentecost. God delivered on His promise by never leaving us, because when we accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, the Holy Spirit indwells us. The Holy Spirit lives in us. All those promises that were prophesied about in Joel are for us today as well. The Spirit is here. The Spirit is welcoming. The Spirit wants to indwell you. The Spirit wants to help you. The Spirit wants to move you. Spirit wants to guide you. God wants to live in you. God wants to help us. God wants to give us that strength and that power that we need to live this life. God wants to receive His Spirit and His power so we can do amazing things for His honor and for His glory. Don't cut God short. Don't put God in this little box. God wants to do amazing things. Look at all the things in the Scriptures that we see. You know, with parting of the Red Sea, walls of Jericho, Daniel in the lion's den, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, we see the miracles that Jesus performed. including raising him from the dead. And that same power lives in us. Why do we put God in a box? That same spirit, that same power God has given us today to use for his honor and for his glory. It's time for the church to stop walking around powerless. It's time for the church to wake up. It's time for the church to stop being mediocre. It's time for the church to stop worrying about what society thinks. And it's time for the church to step up and allow the Spirit of God to move. This country needs to see the Spirit of God move. Just like those people who came to see the sermon at Pentecost. They came from all over. And people were mocking and people were amazed. 3,000 people got saved that day. We need that. We need people of God to step up and allow the Spirit of God to work so that people can hear the gospel, so that people can be discipled, so that lives can be changed. We need to focus on the Lord and rely on His Spirit. Stop being afraid. Go hard after Him and do what God is calling us to do. To evangelize, to make disciples. You up for that? Are you up for that challenge? Because I guarantee you step up for God, there's got to be persecution. People might make fun of you, people might mock you. And it might even happen, other Christians might do it. You step up for God, you live for God, you will get mocked. You'll get persecuted. And Jesus himself said, if they persecute me, they're going to persecute you. It's going to happen. Is that sacrifice worth it? Are you ready to step up for God? Are you ready to allow the Spirit to work? I'm ready, and I'm willing. Not that I'm going to be perfect, none of us are, but I'm ready and willing to be used by God however He sees fit. And I pray that you will join me on that. Join me to allow God to use us, to use His church for His honor, for His glory, to see people come to Him. Then we'll have revival. And it's going to be a great day. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for this morning. God, I thank you for your Spirit. God, I thank you for your power and for your strength. God, I pray for everyone watching, God, that we will, everyone including myself, God, will stand up for you. God, that we won't worry about what others think. God, that we won't worry about what you have for us. God, to use your strength, use your Spirit, God, to stand up and live a life worthy of the calling that you have called us to. God, that we wouldn't fear. That we wouldn't worry. God, we just live for you. Be bold about it. God, we thank you and praise you for what you're doing. We love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Once again, I want to thank you guys for worshiping with us this morning. Just a reminder that next Sunday, we'll have our open house here from 9 to 11. You can stop by at any time during those 2 hours. It's going to be a great time. I'll be sending more information out. Until then, we love you and we're praying for you. God bless. See you next week.
That endureth, thine own dear presence.
Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness.